And I am a pastor at a fellowship church, and you have joined us tonight for our webinar. And this webinar, coming out of our Center for Racial Reconciliation, is called The Forgotten Genocide: History, Theology, and Stories of the Armenian Massacres. This will be a rich night, and the title encapsulates it all. We're going to be talking about history, theology, and stories as it pertains to the Armenian Genocide. And first and foremost, I just want to say thank you for being here. This is going to be a holy time together. It's going to be a powerful time together. It's going to be a rich time together. I also want to just say I am your host. But I join you not as an expert in any way, shape, or form, but first and foremost, just a friend to many Armenians in my life who have opened up my eyes, not only to the history, but to the current happenings in this community. And so I show up as a friend first and foremost. I show up as a pastor, just representing Fellowship Church, and I show up as a learner. I'm so looking forward to learning tonight. So if you are here and you know all about everything that we're going to be talking about, we welcome you. If you are here and you are new and you are just looking to learn, we welcome you and we are so thankful that you are here. I want to introduce a video from our senior pastor as he just wants to welcome everybody tonight and say a couple words. So without further ado, let's just point our attention to this video to hear some words from our senior pastor, Albert Tate.
Hey, family, so thankful to be in this space with so many of you. It's always a pleasure when we can get together. I can't wait till we can get together in these moments without the restriction of COVID, because not only do we do the hard business of remembering and reflecting, but we also do some good eating and some good fellowship. Some of my best fellowship time have been with my brothers and sisters in this community. So thankful for you. I think one of the most important things for us to do is never, ever, ever forget where we came from. And to never forget those that have come before us, upon whose shoulders we stand. And to never, ever forget those that lost their lives, those whom their lives were taken. Because you would think you can forget those things because those things will never ever happen again. But no, we know better. And we're learning better every day. If we forget our past, then we're doomed to repeat it. So I'm so thankful for your courage, for your commitment to never forgetting. And may we never forget. And may we all come together and remember together. I just want you to know, not only is your fellowship family, but your African American siblings, not that I can speak on behalf of all of them, but as far as the ones that are in my circle of influence, we won't forget, and we will always sit in remembrance so that we might continue to become the people that God would have us to be, and that will stand against injustice and will stand for everyone to experience the beauty of the fullness of God's glory. Those who were made in the Imago Dei. May you enjoy your time. May it be marked by God's presence. And I am honored to be an honorary member of this family and this community. Thank you guys so much. Love you. And may we never, ever forget.
We're so thankful for those words from our senior pastor. And if you are not a part of our church, we just want to say welcome. And at Fellowship, we always say we're a gospel-centered, multi-ethnic, intergenerational church, and we exist to make disciples. And for us, the gospel really speaks to this idea of reconciliation. All of scripture speaks to this idea of reconciliation, and we take it really, really seriously. And we don't think it's a side issue of the gospel, but we believe it's intrinsic to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the work that we are doing tonight, this webinar and this time that we get to have together, really does not only come from our church, but specifically from our Center for Racial Reconciliation. And I just wanted to take a minute and honor our director for the Center of Racial Reconciliation, John Williams, and all the incredible work that he's done and all of his efforts in making this night happen, and just wanted to welcome him and just have him say a couple words to us.
Hey, good evening, everyone. I am so excited about tonight. We started talking about this event several months ago, and honestly, it started, and I think she's here tonight, with Julie Palladian. She had posted something on Facebook asking non-Armenians to stand in support of Armenians and the genocide that happened and the genocide that's continuing to happen. And so it was her Facebook post that kind of was the seedling for this. And I reached out, and Steve Adamian and Seta and so many other folks, we got together, and I've just been so excited about having this evening. The Center for Racial Reconciliation, if we were to define reconciliation in four words, it would be truth, repentance, repair, and forgiveness. And tonight we want to talk about the truth component, right? We want to talk about the history of our dear brothers and sisters in the Armenian community. And I've just been so looking forward to this, and we welcome every single person. I noticed that there are people who are not a part of fellowship and who are from all parts of the country. And so we want to welcome you to the Center for Racial Reconciliation as we host this wonderful event this evening. We want you to learn, to listen, and we'll give you some response opportunities at the end of our evening tonight. And so, Michael, thank you so much for allowing me to have a few words. And again, welcome to everyone who's here this evening. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much, John. I love you as a brother and as a friend, and just so thankful for your leadership. He is an incredible leader. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to get out of the way, because we're here to learn and we are here to receive the richness that is about to come. I will introduce our panelists for the evening all at once, and then I will go a little bit deeper into their bios right before they present, just so that we can just say a hello to them before we fully get into it. The first woman that I want to introduce tonight is Ani Hovhannisyan. And we are so thankful that you are here, Ani. She has done so much incredible work in her field, and we will get to her bio when it's time for her to present. But without further ado, I want to introduce our first two presenters. Excuse me. They are sisters, and they are a powerhouse duo. Doris and Arda Melkonian are just these amazing sisters. So Doris is a graduate student at Fuller Theological Seminary. Doris holds a BA in English Literature and MA in Musicology from UCLA. Arda is a graduate student as well at Fuller. She has her BS and MA in Mathematics from UCLA. So we've got some sharp cookies here on our hands. As granddaughters of Armenian genocide survivors, Doris and Arda are passionate about researching the Armenian genocide and giving voice to those who suffered. They have conducted research on survivor testimonies and archives around the world, which they have published in book chapters. Doris and Arda have presented their research at conferences in the United States and at international conferences in Armenia, Australia, Cambodia, France, Greece, Israel, Turkey. They were featured in a CNN Turkey documentary on Islamized Armenians, and interviewed in Yerevan for the television show Good Morning Armenia. Their current research explores the intersection of faith and the Armenian genocide. To start our conversation by giving us a contextual and historical perspective, would you please welcome Doris and Arda Melkonian?
Hey. Thank you, Michael. And we want to thank the Fellowship Center for Racial Reconciliation for organizing tonight's event and for inviting us. Thank you so much for creating this space to commemorate the Armenian Genocide and to honor the memory of our ancestors. It means so much to us and to the Armenian community. And so we just are so, so thankful, and we are so honored to be with you tonight. And thank you to all of you who have joined us this evening, or today, or this morning, wherever you are in the world with different time zones. So the first segment of today's webinar, we are going to start with a brief historical overview. And I'm going to share my screen because we have some PowerPoint slides prepared. Okay. And I have the daunting task of presenting 3,000 years of history in about 5 minutes. So I'm going to do my best. And the goal here is just to give you a little background about Armenia and speak a little bit about this nation that experienced genocide. And then Doris is going to give an overview of the Armenian Genocide. So Armenia is a small nation with a 3,000 year history. And I'm going to put up a slide of the current borders of Armenia. So this is a landlocked country in the Caucasus region. And if you the borders of Armenia, we've got Turkey, Iran, Azerbaijan, and Georgia to the north. Now, historic Armenia was a much larger nation. And so here's a map of Greater Armenia. And you can see that it extends from the Mediterranean Sea to the Caspian Sea. So these were the borders of Armenia at its height. And Armenia lies in the region in the biblical mountains of Ararat. And Ararat is the resting place of Noah's Ark. And this is a symbol, it's a national symbol for Armenians. Now, I'm going to go back to our slide here. As with other nations, geography has played a defining role for Armenia. So it's situated between Asia and Europe, and therefore it's been repeatedly attacked and has experienced destruction and persecution throughout its history. So Armenia has been invaded and ruled by Assyrians, Greeks, Romans, Persians, Arabs, Kurds, Turks, Mongols, Turkmen, and Russians. Its location has also had its benefits. Because of its location on a major trade route, this has allowed the people of Armenia to prosper financially and to enrich their culture. Now, the traditional Armenian view of the origins of the Armenian people is that the Armenian people are the descendants of Japheth, the son of Noah. So the myth is that Haig, the descendant of Japheth, fought and killed the Babylonian leader Bel and created the Armenian nation. Now the historical account, so historians and archaeologists tell us that the first appearance of the Armenians occurs towards the end of the 7th century BC. They were known as Araradians, named after Mount Ararat. For the next several hundred years, they fought against and came under the domination of the Assyrians, the Medes, and the Persians. And we've read about the Assyrian Empire in the Bible. We know the stories about Jonah and Nineveh. So these are familiar to us from the Bible, the Assyrians, the Medes, the Persians, the Babylonians. After Alexander the Great attacked the Persian Empire, Armenia came under Hellenistic rule. And then when the Hellenistic Empire was defeated by Rome, Armenian state was founded. And at its height in the first century BC, here's a map again of Greater Armenia. It ruled over the Caucasus, parts of modern day Turkey, Iran, Israel, Syria, and Lebanon. And for a time, Armenia was one of the most powerful states in the region. After the first century AD, Armenia came under Roman control. Now, according to tradition, the Armenian Apostolic Church was established by two of Jesus's 12 apostles, Thaddeus, who we know as Judas the Zealot or Jude, and Bartholomew, who preached Christianity in Armenia from the 40s to the 60s AD. In the year 301 AD, Armenia became the first nation to accept Christianity as a state religion. And the Armenian church is called the Armenian Apostolic Church. It's an Orthodox church, but the reason it's apostolic is because of we want to emphasize that it was established by Jesus' apostles. It's an Orthodox tradition, but it's independent of the other Orthodox churches. In 405 AD, the Armenian alphabet was created, and this was created primarily for translating the Bible into the Armenian language. During this period, Christianity flourished. And with the invention of the Armenian alphabet, there was a golden age of Armenian literature. In the fifth century, the ancient Armenian kingdom was split between Byzantium and Persia. One of the most important events in Armenian history worth highlighting during the discussion about Armenian society Battle of Avaray. The Armenians, and this battle was between the Armenians and the Persians in the year 451 AD. Now we're focusing on this event because it shows the character of the faith and the persistence of the Armenian people. And we will see later that this is one aspect why the Armenians were killed during the Armenian genocide. So what happened with the Battle of Avaray is that the Persian king wanted to impose the Zoroastrian religion on Armenians. The Armenians refused to convert, and the clergy and princes wrote a letter to the Persian king in which they said, "From this faith, no one can shake us, neither angels nor men, neither sword nor fire nor water, nor any or all other horrid tortures. All our goods and possessions are in your hands. Our bodies are before you. Dispose of them if you will. If you leave us to our belief, we will, here on earth, choose no other master in your place, and in heaven, no other God in place of Jesus Christ, for there is no other God. But should you require anything beyond this great testimony, here we are. Our bodies are in your hands. Do with them as you please. Tortures from you, submission from us. The sword is yours, the neck is ours." This defiant statement angered the Persian king, and he attacked the Armenians. The Armenians suffered a military defeat, but they were eventually allowed to keep their faith. The Persians relinquished any plans of converting Armenia to their pagan religion when they realized that the Armenians were not going to forsake their God. Afterwards, there were two centuries under Persian rule, and Armenia then came under Arab domination for another two centuries, and then regained its independence, and an Armenian kingdom was established in the 9th century. After a brief period of independence, the kingdom fell in the 11th century to the Seljuk Turks. Many Armenians fled to Cilicia, which is here, It's not part of the Armenian Highlands. It borders the Mediterranean. And this was an Armenian kingdom from the 11th to the 14th centuries. Between the 16th and the 19th centuries, the Armenian homeland came under the rule of Ottoman. And by the 19th century, Eastern Armenia had been conquered by the Russian Empire, and Western Armenia remained under Ottoman rule. And it is in this context that the genocide occurred. After the genocide, the collapse of the Russian Empire led to the establishment of the First Republic of Armenia in 1918. 2 years later, came under Soviet rule when the Soviet Union collapsed its independence in 1991. Through the many centuries of foreign domination, the Armenian Apostolic Church has served as the guardian of Armenian national identity. Since its establishment, it has played a pivotal role in preserving the identity of the Armenian people and its culture. And after the genocide, the Armenian Apostolic Church was also instrumental in helping rebuild the nation. So this is a picture of the Mother See of Holy Echmiadzin in Yerevan. Since we're going to be talking about Nagorno-Karabakh, I want to just give a brief background about the history. Nagorno-Karabakh is this region here. And the name Nagorno comes from the Russian Nagorny, which means highland, and Karabakh, which is a compound Turkic and Iranian words, which mean black garden. The Armenians refer to this region as Artsakh. Armenians have lived in this region since as early as the 7th century BC. And it was one of the provinces of the Armenian kingdom in the 2nd century BC. And so there's been a continuous Armenian presence in these lands. After the Sovietization of Armenia and Azerbaijan in 1921, Stalin decided that Artsakh would remain within Azerbaijan, even though the majority of the population was Armenian. In 1988, Armenians in Artsakh sought unification with the Armenian Republic, and then after the collapse of the Soviet Union, voted for the creation of an independent state. The first war of Artsakh started in 1988 and ended in 1994, with Armenia in full control of the enclave and surrounding territories. The second war was launched by Azerbaijan with the assistance of Turkey in September 27 of last year. We will hear more about the recent war later in the presentation, but let's first turn our attention to the Armenian genocide, which Doris will present for us. So I wanted to provide a background to the Armenian genocide and give you a context as to why it happened. The extermination of Armenians in the Ottoman Empire and neighboring regions during 1915 to 1925 is called the Armenian Genocide. I'm sorry, 1915 to 1923. The genocide was planned and perpetrated by the Ottoman Empire, the Young Turks. The Young Turks was a political reform movement. In 1911, in a secret meeting in Thessaloniki, Greece, the Young Turks arrived at a quote unquote solution to what they considered the Armenian problem. The solution was to exterminate the Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire. The plan was conceived in 1911 to 1912, but implemented during World War I. When the nationalist radical wing of the Young Turks gained control led by Talat Pasha, Enver Pasha, and Jemal Pasha. They carried out the genocide, their solution, quote unquote, to the Armenian problem. Now, massacres before the genocide took place between 1894 to 1896. There were massacres of Armenians in the Ottoman Empire called the Hamidian massacres, named after Sultan Abdul Hamid. 300,000 Armenians were killed. Several years later, in 1909, in the city of Adana, around 20 to 25,000 Armenians were massacred. These massacres are not considered genocide, since they were not state-sponsored killings. Now, Pan-Turkism is an ideology that gained traction in the 1880s. It was a political movement whose goal was the cultural and political unification of all Turkic peoples. Pan-Turkism is a term used to describe the political, cultural, and ethnic unity of all Turkic-speaking people. The word pan comes from the Greek, which means all. The goal is to unite Turkic-speaking people. The goal from the westernmost tip of Turkey to Kazakhstan, which borders China and Mongolia. As part of their policies of Turkification, the Young Turks also tried to annihilate the Greek and the Assyrian populations in their lands. There was a Greek genocide and an Assyrian genocide. As part of their ethnic cleansing campaign to eliminate all non-Turkic, non-Muslim inhabitants. As with many other genocides in history, the Armenian genocide was a deliberate, state-organized attempt at exterminating a particular group. An understanding of this magnitude requires state resources to implement. The Armenian genocide occurred in multiple phases. In February 1915, the Ministry of War had disarmed the Armenian recruits in the Ottoman army, and they were assigned to labor battalions and worked as slaves. The initial stage of the genocide was the elimination of the male population, those who might pose a resistance. The second phase was the arrest of several hundred Armenian leaders on April 24, 1915, and their murder. The community leaders, the intellectuals, the clergy of the community were eliminated. Here is a map of the massacre sites, and the size of the red circles represent the number of deaths. The larger the red circle, the larger the number of deaths. The red arrows that you see from all over reaching down to reaching through down to the through the deserts of Syria are the massacre death marches. These are the routes that Armenians went on. The third phase was the massacres of women, children, and elderly by sending them off into the deserts of Syria. Hundreds of thousands of people were sent on death marches. During the deportations, they were killed by Turkish soldiers, police officers, and Kurdish bandits. Many others died of disease, starvation, dehydration, exposure to the elements, and drowning. During the deportations, thousands of women and children were sexually assaulted. Lastly, tens of thousands of Armenians were forced to convert to Islam. The reason we commemorate the Armenian genocide on April 24 is because the Turkish government arrested over 200 Armenian community leaders in Constantinople, today's Istanbul. They were sent to the interior of Anatolia and executed. Prior to April 24, Armenians were being tortured and killed, but it was being done in secret. With the arrest of April 24, the plans of the Young Turk regime became apparent. So before the genocide, there were approximately 2 million Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire. Between 1915 to 1923, it is estimated that 1.5 million Armenians were killed. The remaining 500,000 were either Islamized or dispersed. The international community condemned atrocities committed against the Armenians. The great powers, Great Britain, France, and Russia, warned the Turkish leadership that they would be held responsible. In the US, reports of the atrocities prompted humanitarian efforts to ensure shows is of the Near East Relief that supported Armenians during the genocide. After the genocide, the international community failed to hold Turkey responsible for its crimes. The denial of the Turkish government is the final phase of the genocide. Turkey uses every means possible. It distorts history, it uses propaganda, it lobbies foreign powers and companies against Armenians and all humanity. Scholars have documented attempts by the Turkish government to erase all evidence of Armenian indigenous existence in their homeland. For example, names of villages are replaced with Turkish ones or Turkish sounding ones. They engage in historical revisionism. They claim that Armenians never had a state of their own, that they are alien and not indigenous to the Caucasus and Anatolia. They destroy Armenian churches, monasteries, monuments, cemeteries, any and all evidence of Armenian existence. We will now hear from a genocide survivor, Mrs. Yevnige Salipyan. Mrs. Salipyan and her husband, Reverend Salipyan, were our pastors in Beirut, Lebanon. When my father was pursuing his degree in the United States, Reverend Salipyan and his wife would visit us regularly. This is a picture of them at one of their visits to our house. Arda is on Mrs. Salipyan's lap, and I'm in front of Reverend Salipyan. Reverend and Mrs. Salipyan would pray with my mother and pray over us. They were a constant reminder of God's love and care for our family and blessing to us and the entire community. We are so delighted that Ani Hovhannisyan had the opportunity to interview Mrs. Salipyan and to produce this segment. We will now hear the interview.
When I was growing up, we knew that Turks are not our friends, our enemies. They used to kill us. We were afraid. It's hard to recall those things, you know. Now everything is new for us. This country is so much blessed. But we experienced bad infancy. I was born in Turkey in the city of Antep, 1914, January 14, I was born. In a Christian family, in Eintracht. It was wartime, the bombs coming and going. It was wartime. We couldn't go out our houses, our places. We were all, the churches, Sunday schools were at homes. We used to have them there, Sunday schools. And it was in Turkish. Vatan tatlı vatan. Vatan tatlı vatan. Ey sen güzel vatan. Vatan Jesus'un evi. The house of Lord. Parlak güzel vatan.
Did you ever remember hearing the Armenian language anywhere while you were living in Eintracht?
We are not supposed to learn Armenian in the schools. I heard that. My memory is while I was in my home and my family, I heard the knock of the door, tok, 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 tok. We used to see from the cracks of the door, wooden door. And people came and said, yarın, yarın, tomorrow, you will leave your house and go out.
Where?
Out where, I don't know. You will go, they said. You will leave your house and go.
Who is saying this?
The Turks, gendarmes. I remember it very well. My father was a friend of a Turkish man. He was the mayor of the city, Mohammed. And when they came to take us out for Naraklukyanyertal, to the persecution, that man helped us that we could stay 5-6 years more in Antep. And those sceneries come in my mind. There were many, many, many big, big crowds passing through. I used to say, see.
You saw them?
I saw them. And I saw them! Real, this is real. They wanted us out and dead. They had whips in their hand and beating people. Go, walk, walk, walk. When they couldn't walk, they were hungry. They were tired. They are gone, but still I cry. Those children cry, Mommy, bread. Mommy, I am hungry. Mommy, I am very thirsty. My feet doesn't walk anymore. Still I cry. It doesn't go from my memory, never. You cannot compare the living now and the living by then. So many difficult things. Which one I tell? It will not finish. But God brought me till here, now 100 years old and 3 months. This is my fourth country. I was born in Turkey, I was raised in Damascus, I married in Beirut, and after the fourth one is America. And I said, if I go to America, I will go to the old people's home and serve you. And a revival of Armenian spirit of love toward God, toward Jesus, and love each other. Hayaski Kristo yaski or irvisi de vardı. Dobrovelu je včera sa celo in je recent proto bahate večera. They must learn about Armenian history back. How they live, how they were tortured, they were brought out of their city, their houses, out to the world, and they were spread all over the world. Everywhere there are Armenians, and we are God's Vaga Mernik, is Vaga, Vaga.
Oh, yeah.
Witnesses. That we witness, there's a God, there's a purpose for Armenians to live and to spread all over the world. I love my people. I am an Armenian, I will die an Armenian, and a Christian Armenian. I want them to be revived and love the Lord, serve the Lord, and we live. Up there will be no wars, no hatred, no killing, no poverty. Love.
Wow. Such a powerful sharing of the history of Armenia, and such a big takeaway for me is that it wasn't just political persecution, but also persecution for being followers of Jesus Christ. And what a powerful testimony from Yevniga. And we do want to apologize for the lag on the video. That is unfortunately in the COVID times that we're living in, Zoom hasn't quite caught up to streaming videos, and we just thank you for your patience with that, and just want us to just encourage all of us to continue to engage the content even with a little bit of lag on the video. I want to pivot us to another testimony, and this is a testimony from a dear woman, a powerful leader in our church, Lisa Haleblian, and she will be sharing just about her relationship with her grandmother and her grandmother's experience over the years. So let's point our attention to Lisa's testimony.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lisa Haleblian, and my family and I have been part of the Fellowship family for the last 8 years. I've been a crybaby most of my life, or so I've been told. So it's not surprising one of my first memories is as a 3 or 4 year old sobbing child. I was not alone. My nene was with me, but I don't remember her comforting me like you'd imagine a grandmother doing. Instead, she was using one of her scare tactics, sternly admonishing me, "Shadlasne, janjma bitgalles." Basically, stop crying or you're gonna swallow a fly. I clenched my mouth tight, stifling my sobs. I still hate flies. What that vulnerable child didn't realize, and what I now suspect as an adult, is that my nena's impatience was not a withholding of love and affection, but a result of her own childhood trauma. She was only about 8 years old when her father was murdered at gunpoint by men who hated her people. He was hiding in a tunnel built a few weeks earlier when the rumors of murder and deportation were first whispered in the tiny village of Urfa, Turkey. Huddled in the dark with other young men, they listened as the Turkish soldiers shouted at their wives and children, ransacking their homes. At some point, a neighbor, now turned traitor, yelled that it was safe to come out of hiding. As each one emerged, their trust was shattered by the sound of gunshots, their bodies landing in a heap of piling corpses. The women were told to gather their children and whatever belongings that they could carry and join the long caravan of villagers escorted into the desert that would become the grave for over 1.5 million. Now, my nene was a quiet woman. She was only 4 feet 10 inches tall, with long silver hair braided tightly into a bun, who could be found most days sitting with her feet up, reading through the Bible for the 35th or 40th time, though her eyes had long become weak from years of needlework. So when she spoke, and only in Armenian, my brother and I hung on every word, desperate to understand and make sense of the world she described so incongruent with our own. She would tell us about the masses of people who awaited in the hot sun, huddled together, in shock, babies trembling in arms, toddlers clutching their mothers' skirts, grandmothers stooped over canes, carrying the weight of sadness and despair. And the march began, slowly and carefully, with soldiers on horses on both sides, guns ready to shoot the stragglers. After a few days into their journey, out of the public eye and scrutiny, the sojourners faced a more atrocious treatment. Most didn't live to tell about it, but Nene watched in horror as elderly and pregnant young women fell to their deaths from exhaustion, dehydration, and starvation. I remember listening to her as she described to us that babies were left under the shade of a small bush because their mothers literally went crazy listening to their sobs. If you were lucky, you were shot. Many girls as young as her were raped and then shot. You'd think that these would be the stories that gripped me with fear and dread, but it was a more tame story that stuck with me the most as a child. The time when Nene was so thirsty, she was begging her mother for water, eager to quiet her young daughter so as not to draw unwanted attention by the soldiers, she forced her to drink the urine of her older sister. And how my Nene desperately drank it, only to retch it out along with anything left in her growling stomach. How could any mother give their daughter urine to drink, I thought. What kind of world was she living in? Who allowed such a violation of trust between a mother and her child? It was beyond anything my adolescent mind could conjure. Nene's salvation came when a Turkish soldier noticed her and decided her beauty could not be wasted. He took her home as a gift to his wife, where Nene would shovel snow, cook, clean, and sew in exchange for a moldy bowl of rice. It was during one of her errands she overheard a few women whispering in her native tongue, and she carefully approached them, as it was dangerous to be an Armenian, much less Christian, in the Ottoman Empire. Yet these brave Armenian women literally kidnapped Nene and had her transported safely to Aleppo, Syria. There, she would be miraculously reunited with her mother and two older sisters, whose own story involved an Armenian soldier undercover whose sole mission was to secretly steal women from the caravan with the false narrative of taking them back to his village as slaves. These are the nameless heroes that thwarted the dissolution of my family line. Most Armenian kids in my generation heard these eyewitness accounts, especially as April 24 approached. The rest of the year, we were told to speak Armenian, to respect our elders, to keep the faith, and to never get thrown into the melting pot of America. To this day, marrying an Armenian and never moving far away from your family are implicit expectations. Nene lived through many other difficult times in her life, but the last years of her life were happier. She enjoyed her 4 children and 6 grandchildren. Her favorite outing was driving from Glendale to Pasadena to have suj, Turkish coffee, with her oldest daughter as they sat on the veranda, and all the cute Armenian old ladies would come by to say hello and catch up on the gossip. She also loved McDonald's, but she couldn't pronounce it right, so she called it McDonald's, which literally means parsley. My brother and I would giggle at that one, but we were the winners whenever she was craving a Big Mac. As I mentioned earlier, her dim eyes never stopped her from reading her tattered old Bible over and over again. I would think to myself, I never dared ask her, Nene, why would you want to read the same old book so many times? Doesn't it get boring? There are so many other good books out there to read. Well, Nene, I know you'll be happy to hear that I get it now. God's word, which was so precious to you, has now proven alive to me as well. And what better heritage to have given your granddaughter, even if she's still afraid of flies.
Hey, thank you. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Ani. These are beautiful testimonies and interviews of genocide survivors. And now that they're gone, they're so much more precious. And so we're so happy that these were captured and can be shared with others in the future. In this next section, we're going to present some of our findings about the survivors and their faith. The Armenian Genocide had a profound impact on the Armenian people. It was a disruption of life, a disruption from the past, a disruption of everything that was familiar, and inevitably a disruption in their relationship with God. The responses of the genocide survivors span the spectrum, from strengthened faith to weakened faith to even the loss of faith. In the presentation that follows, we will highlight excerpts that focus on faith. These excerpts are drawn from a large body of Armenian genocide survivor testimonies. These testimonies, which number over 1,000, were collected by our professor, Richard Hovhannisyan, and his students in the 1970s and 80s. We became intimately familiar with the survivor accounts as students in Professor Hovhannisyan's oral history classes. And in subsequent years, we served as his teaching assistants for the Armenian oral history class at UCLA. The faith reflections are unique and powerful. They're candid and raw. They are unfiltered expressions of the survivor's theology. They are voluntarily expressed as they were not part of the questionnaire. These expressions occur infrequently within the collection. And therefore, we had to read over 100 survivor testimonies to find the excerpts that we have highlighted in this presentation. Each of these survivors provides a different perspective of life, of survival and faith. While we acknowledge the value of each testimony, we will focus on a handful. In order to understand the excerpts fully, we have contextualized these reflections with a brief background of the survivors. The first excerpt that we will focus on is provided by Serop. Serop was born in 1896. So he was about 19 years old when news reached his village of danger. He recalls the soldiers coming to his village, beating the villagers and killing the men. Serop came from a clan that included 20 families. He was the eldest of 5 brothers and a sister. Out of this clan of 20 families, Serop was the sole survivor, losing all family members and relatives. Serop says, "We are Christian. We are Armenian. We have faith. Every evening on Saturdays and Sundays, we would light candles and pray." Serop establishes the identity of his people, Christian, Armenian, and religious. They are not Christian in name only, but have a strong faith. This is an important declaration made by the survivor who experienced the truth. "When we were children, if we didn't say the Lord's Prayer before we ate, we wouldn't be allowed to eat. And after we finished, we said the Lord's Prayer again. We used to go to church in the morning at 7 and again in the evening." Serop describes the Lord's Prayer bookending their daily meals. In a similar way, attending church bookends their day. Both involve meditation on God and display devotion and reverence. Both acts reveal the significance placed on God and the church. There are several accounts by survivors about the religious devotion of Armenians prior to the genocide. There was a deep reverence for God and a desire to live in communion with Him. The world in which they live is ordered by religiosity. Our next survivor is Armenohi, who was born in 1910 and the youngest of 7 siblings. Armenohi watched as Turkish soldiers viciously beat Armenian men and pressed hot iron rods on their necks. Their screams had been etched in her memory. She tells of how her oldest brother was beaten so severely that he was unrecognizable. She remembers seeing women stripped naked, taken to the edge of the Euphrates River, shot and thrown in the river. Even after witnessing these atrocities, Arminui's faith is unshakable, and she declares, "I have my God and my church. I go to church every Sunday." This is in response to the question that the interview asked, "Do you go to church every Sunday?" She continues, the interviewer asks, "Did you learn this from your mother?" Arminui responds, "Whatever I learned from my mother, I continue to do to this day." When Arminui says, "I have my God and my church," it is a powerful declaration from a genocide survivor who has lost everything. The one thing that she has, the most important thing, is her God. This excerpt also reveals the significant role played by parents in the religious training of their children. The religious instruction provided by the parents, usually the mothers, at childhood remains with survivors into adulthood, regardless of the turmoil in their lives. Now, this statement reminds me of the faith of our own grandparents who were survivors of the genocide. I am reminded of my own maternal grandfather, Nathan Kuyumjian, who was approximately 10 years old during the genocide. As an adult, every morning, my grandfather would commit the workday to the Lord, say the Lord's Prayer, and then enter his place of business. The religious devotion and the practices are things he learned as a child from his parents. His mother was able to raise a child that continued to have faith as an adult. This picture is my grandparents, Nathan and Eulenia, with their two daughters, my mother Jeanette and my aunt Betty. Arminui's faith reminds me of my paternal grandmother, Barkevui Malkonian, a woman of great faith. Here she is with my father, Reverend Malkonian. Her experiences during the genocide did not shake her faith. She had her God and her church, and she would often declare, "My God is an almighty God. He can do all things." Returning to our survivors of the genocide, we encounter Khatun, who was born in 1901. There were 10 people in her family, and she recalls going to church with her family every Sunday morning. She remembers being sent home one school day and told to stay indoors. She remembers being warned that the Turks won their way and they were coming to butcher them. Khatun says, "I believe in the Lord. I believe in God the Father, and I believe in him until the end." Still and until the end, two phrases that describe her devotion. The word "still" means it hasn't changed. Her faith has continued. Despite the suffering she experienced, her faith remained steadfast. The phrase "until the end," it continues and will continue. This is a declaration of her faithfulness. These are three statements of belief. I believe, I believe, I will believe. There are three short statements, repetitious and rhythmic. In some ways, they remind us of the Nicene Creed. Khatun is another example of a survivor with unwavering faith. Her experiences during the genocide have no effect on her faith. Now we return to Arminui. And Arminui says, "I know God. I call unto God. God has saved me from the atrocities in Kharpert. I will never forget God's goodness." Armel Nivui's words demonstrates a personal relationship with God that she can call on him and be heard. These two phrases of declaration, I know and I call. She knows God. She has the assurance that when she calls on him, he will answer. God hears her and delivers her. God was present during her distress. She senses God's presence in her survival. Adminui is a survivor whose faith was strengthened by the deliverance of God. Her faith is reinforced because she prayed to be saved and she was saved. For her, God is alive and he intervened. We encounter another survivor named Hagop, who was born in 1907. He was only 7 years old when the genocide began. His sister was abducted by Turkish neighbors and his four brothers were killed. Hagop says, God should have performed a miracle. They were people of faith. God still not save them. For Hagop, God exists, but he's disappointed. God, how could the God they had worshiped and praised ignore their cries for help? This response is reminiscent of Old Testament expectations when the Israelites called out to God in their distress. We read the psalmist who cries out to God for deliverance. In Psalm 4, we read, answer me when I call, O God. Hagop seems to be asking God to intervene as he did in the past when he delivered the Israelites. These survivors knew the Old Testament stories and are expecting God to behave in a way that represents the theology of the Old Testament. Also, Hagop articulates an expectation that one's obedience will result in God meeting one's expectations. Another survivor, Puzant, who was born in 1895, witnessed the beating of his father, and he later discovered his father's dead body in the field. Puzant also witnessed the gruesome death of his uncle. He watched the Turks as they tied up his uncle, pour gasoline on him, and set him on fire. Puzant's response was, does God not have eyes? Does he not have ears? I don't know. Puzant is not questioning God's existence, but his nature. His convictions have been replaced with questions. Holocaust survivor Elie Wiesel writes that during crisis, certainties of faith turn into questions and doubts. Puzant remains a believer, but his faith has been weakened. The genocide destroyed his image of God as a personal God who is involved in the affairs of humans. He is experiencing an erosion of his childhood beliefs. There's an incompatibility between the God of his childhood and the suffering he witnessed. He appears to be struggling with his faith and still hasn't worked out these conflicts. Our final excerpt comes from Vehanush. Vehanush was born in 1909. She remembers the deportations very well. She describes it in the middle of the night. The soldiers broke down the door and took her father. This was the last time she saw her father alive. Vehanush witnessed young women being sexually assaulted and men killed. As a young child, these experiences caused her to have nightmares. She would wake up in a sweat, screaming. The most striking example of a survivor losing her faith is Vehanush, who declared that she was once a firm Protestant believer who has now relinquished all faith in God. When asked if she is religious, Vehanush responds, honestly, no. At one time, I used to be Protestant. But after all that I have seen in the genocide, all I could think was, where were you, dear Lord, when all this happened? Did you not see all that happened to the Armenians? If there is a God, there would be some fairness, some justice, she says. Vehanosh's fate has been shattered. Her fate has been radically changed, and she has turned away from God. Where were you? She asks. She feels abandoned by God, and she responds by total rejection of him. God's silence is the ultimate betrayal, and she can no longer believe in him. Vehanosh says that she was a Protestant, and Protestants usually think about God and talk about God in a very personal way. Because of her personal relationship, she talks to God directly, unlike Hagop and Puzant, who talk about God. Vehanosh talks to God, and she has the courage to challenge God. Where were you? And confront him. Did you not see? Because of her personal relationship, she has expectations of God that were unmet. The one who failed was God. Vehanosh worshiped God because he was just and fair. If there is no justice and fairness in what is around us, then according to Vehanosh, God does not exist. This is a radical response that was shared by some of the survivors. We should use this example to understand that difficult circumstances can change people that consider themselves firm believers. To conclude, we have examined different religious responses to God in the midst of suffering. There are many voices that we encountered. What can we learn from the different responses people have had to suffering? Sometimes God allows things in our lives that go beyond our understanding. From those whose faith remains steadfast, we can learn that we need to keep worshiping God, even when we are living in things that hurt. For these survivors, their pain did not extinguish their faith. For the survivors who were contending with God, it is likely that crying out to God may be the only way to maintain a relationship with him. We should not judge them since we did not experience their suffering. Struggling with God may be a way of discovering who he is. Doing so allows them to gain a new perspective of themselves, of God, and of their relationship with him. Maybe we have expectations of God that are incorrect or incomplete. As Christians, when we go through pain, expecting God to always rescue us might be wrong. These survivors show us how to struggle with God. They had an expectation to be rescued, and for them, God did not show up. Their testimonies, just like the Psalms of Lament, show us how to struggle in our understanding of God's ways, to express our cries of why and how long. Finally, even if we are very disappointed, God can still work in our lives. Even if we are experiencing pain, God is alive, and he is not done with those who are suffering. Thank you for your kind attention.
That was so rich, the content that they were giving us. And we also want to honor your time that you've given to us here. And so what I want to do is I want to pivot us to our last panelist, our last presenter tonight. And I mentioned her up top, but I just want to do a brief bio for her, just so you know who she is and what she brings. It is Ani Hovhannisyan. She is a director, producer, and filmmaker. From sparse hospital rooms in Siberia to backstage green rooms at the Grammys, Ani Hovhannisyan has produced and directed hundreds of inspiring true events for television and other international audiences. Active in the Armenian American community since childhood, she was also an anchor and reporter at Telenairi and Horizon Armenian Television in Los Angeles for more than a decade. She has just completed her first feature documentary, The Hidden Map, born of the destruction and resilience of a now gone generation of genocide victims and survivors. The film is scheduled to make its broadcast premiere on NBCLX on April 23rd, 24th, and 25th of this year. Ani is a member of the Directors Guild of America, the Television Academy, and the International Documentary Association with degrees from UCLA and USC. We have heard of the history of Armenia. We have heard of the history of the genocide. We have received stories from people who lived it. And now let's welcome Ani as she gives us her perspective just as a storyteller, and so much more than that, but just through the lens of her storytelling. Ani, we're so glad you're with us. Take us away.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate your invitation. Thank you to all of you. I'm sorry that we have to be here today, because in a better world, we wouldn't have to be thinking about racial reconciliation. We would all appreciate each other's lives and beings, differences and similarities. That makes us the rich fabric of humanity. Unfortunately, that's not the case. And today, as John was beginning and he was talking about the four stages of racial reconciliation, he said the first one is truth. And just before he said that, I was thinking to myself that, what is this about? This is about the truth. Before there could be any kind of reconciliation, there has to be an acknowledgement of the truth. There has to be an understanding, a desire to know the truth. And the Armenian truth has been buried by much of the world, certainly by Turkey, for over a century. It's been forgotten intentionally, perhaps unintentionally in some cases. But the truth has been very much alive in me all of my life, because the voices of truth, the voices of my grandparents and of an entire generation of survivors have filled me since my childhood. I will be very brief. I know that we're short on time, but I was born in Fresno, California, and my grandparents and parents gave us a golden childhood. My three brothers, my cousins, the eight of us would be playing in the front yard on Low Avenue, and hide and seek and Red Rover. And at the same time, my grandparents, Khenguhi and Hobagim, Sirun and Kaspar, and a whole generation of survivors would be sitting on the porch of 3312 Low Avenue. And they would be navigating the pain of the past. They would be silently, but not so silently, sharing that impossible pain of having lost their entire homeland, of having lost their families. My grandfather lost all eight of his siblings, his parents, his grandparents. My grandfather was snatched from his mother and lived with Kurds so that he could survive. But his mother and brother and baby in the belly disappeared on death marches forever. His father was killed. My other grandmother saw her 2 6-month twin siblings taken away. Her mother, her father separated. She was growing up in orphanages, and all of this nightmare reality truth that somehow they were able to survive and pick up from and be reborn from and live in exile as survivors, but also as people who started anew. All these stories were happening on the porch of Low Avenue, and they filled me. And so did the testimony of those thousand survivors that Arda and Doris were just talking about, those survivors who my father and his students interviewed. And then God got made their testimony permanent. Anyway, so these voices are very much alive in me and have been all my life. They gave us the window to my past, our past, and the roadmap to my future. And it's that with that roadmap that I said, I have to go see our historic lands. I have to go face the hell and the horror of it, and the miracle of it also. And so I headed out with my father and with a smaller group of journeyers to historic Armenia, Eastern Turkey, where Armenians don't dare go. People don't dare go because you're not allowed to talk about the genocide in Turkey. It's a forbidden past, it is a buried past, and you go to prison. If you talk about the genocide in Turkey, it is against the law because they have done everything in their power to kill that past, as they have tried to kill the people, as they've tried to kill even the memory of their existence. But you see, we're here and we're alive, and that's why we're here, to carry on what they gave us, the life they gave us, and to build a better world based on truth and based on respect of the truth and of others. So I went and was shocked at what I found, because as much as Turkey tries to erase all traces of the Armenian past, they can't do it. The relics and remains of Armenian churches and monasteries are everywhere in this completely Muslim world, where they don't want any trace of anything Armenian. They are standing there shouting out, saying, we are still here. And so are lots of other surprises, actually, that I found when I was there. What I'm going to do first, one of the big surprises I found was a Scottish explorer. And that Scottish explorer's journey and mine, the intersection of our journeys, it is what became the foundation of this film, which I have just completed, called The Hidden Map. And what I'd like to do now is share just a 2-minute summary trailer of that film, and then I'll go on to tell you what, to me, the biggest surprises were and takeaways.
The more I look, the more bones I see. What on earth is a huge structure like this doing here in the middle of nowhere?
I was warned against coming and warned to not be interested in Armenian things, because the Armenian past of Turkey was a forbidden past.
7,000 miles away in Los Angeles, I, an American Armenian, was living cut off from the physical touch of my roots. My grandparents' voices and a lifetime of longing drove me across the world to find my beginnings. That's when I met this Scottish explorer.
What's your name?
Stephen Sim.
Now, we're off to uncover places not found on modern maps, civilizations that have vanished from the face of the earth.
I'm looking for Ermeni.
No Ermeni.
Ermeni buradan gitti, göç etti.
Forbidden, sir. Don't photo.
There it goes. If somebody maliciously demolished an historic building in Britain, they would be prosecuted.
Where did the Armenians go?
I don't know. You know better than me.
There could be no justification for what was done in these lands.
Probably nowhere else has already so much been destroyed. I'm here to give those monuments a voice.
We have lost past.
Bu bağlar Ermeni bağıdır.
Tarihle artık yüzleşmeliyiz.
Follow the clues. Look beneath the surface, and you'll begin to see the hidden map.
So that's just a glimpse into the world that we uncovered. It's a glimpse into the reality that so much still remains in historic Armenia, in Kharpert and Van and Erzurum and Mush and Dikranagerd and Kesaryan, Gars, and all these Erzurum, all these places that all of many of you have heard about, that almost became like these mythical places. They're real and they're living. And the biggest shock of all is not only that there is still evidence of our creation and existence and destruction in those lands. Evidence that wants us to go and see it and touch it and feel it and honor it, not to forget that they are still there. But it's the voices of the living people that was most affecting to me. The fact that Kurds and Turks who know that it's dangerous to talk about it. Of course, there were those who say, oh, nothing happened. Oh, Armenians are bad. And you kind of see that the same evil that killed your people, you can see it sometimes in some of the people there. But surprisingly, there are people there, Turks and Kurds, whose grandparents did kill our people, who live almost needing to redeem themselves. One man told me in Diyarbakir, my grandfather, a Kurd, killed 12 Armenians, and my grandmother told him, you kill one more and I will leave you. This man now living in that country is hungry to redeem himself, to right the wrongs of his forefathers and mothers. And likewise, I came across people who said to me, my grandmother was Armenian. My grandmother was saved by a Turk or a Kurd and grew up a Kurd, but then told us, or I heard her saying the Lord's Prayer, or I found it in the diary box, or somehow there are these people who found their Armenian identity, and as dangerous as it is, they want to cling to it, they want to claim it. And so meeting them, it confirmed to me that our story is not dead. For me, it never was. And it's not ancient history, and it's not irrelevant. It's part of the human experience. It's part of the human reality. And these people living there are our living link to the past. There is a church that was opened in Diyarbakir, an Armenian church that was opened, a 700-year-old Armenian church with 7 altars, the biggest in the Middle East. It was opened in Turkey 7 years ago because the mayor of Diyarbakir was pro-Armenian and he helped a Kurd. Unfortunately, and when I went there, it was overwhelming to see, I'm sorry, but this church was open and had hundreds of people there who were hungry for their culture, for their identity, and some of them even for their religion. That church today is closed because it was damaged and because the Turks tried to take it back. But just 3 days ago on Easter Day, I received an email from the woman whom you saw just now saying, we have a lost past. This is a woman who grew up as a Kurd. But she found out she's Armenian. She always knew there was something in her different. She claimed her Armenian identity, her heritage, and she converted to Christianity. And she sent me an email 3 days or on Easter Day inside Surp Girago's church, which has been completely damaged, no more pews, no more anything, completely damaged. Somehow she got in. And she lit a candle on Easter Day. And she took a picture of herself with her candle in Surp Girago's with her cross in a country where she could lose everything for doing it. But does it because she gains everything by doing it. She finds herself. And so we need to find ourselves in relation to this woman, in relation to each other, in relation to truth. And I thank you all. And my father says, Tebi Haraç, we go forward. So thank you. Oh, I guess I'm not done, because we talk about genocide continuing as it does. And I just want to share now, I'm sorry, I completely forgot about this, that you know, many of you know, some might not, that in September, Artsakh, which is an Armenian republic, which has been Armenian for thousands of years, and that has been where Armenians have been living peacefully for thousands of years. On September 27th of last year was attacked by Azerbaijan. And with the full support of Turkey, with the expressed overt support of Turkey, saying we will do everything to support Azerbaijan, it is a continuation of the genocide. They want to destroy everything Armenian. Unfortunately, they have been successful because, not quite successful, because we're still here and Armenians will always be here. We will always be resilient. We will not die. And with our faith, with our determination, with our resilience, we will not die. But they want us to. So Artsakh has been devastated. Much of it has been taken over by Azerbaijan now. And they are destroying our cultural monuments. They are destroying our churches there. Half the population has been uprooted. And instead of talking about this continuing genocide, this evil that continues in this world that we're living in because we allow it to, because it's not happening on our soil, in our house, so it doesn't matter, but it's happening. So instead of talking about what I witnessed when I went back there in November, after the attacks had stopped and after a very painful ceasefire agreement had been signed, handing over much of Artsakh to Azerbaijan / Turkey, this is what I experienced.
Entering Artsakh. Pari kalust Artsakh. Welcome to Artsakh. In the late days of November 2020, facing the heart-wrenching reality that much of Artsakh would soon be in the hands of Azerbaijan, I returned to our ancient Armenian soil. The images of destruction that had flooded our lives for more than 40 days replayed in my head.
Shushi yesterday was targeted not once but twice, a double hit on the cathedral there, when it was very clear that civilians and journalists were sheltering inside.
This is what life has been like in Nagorno-Karabakh's capital, Stepanakert.
And then I saw it with my own eyes. The once bustling streets were now empty, except for soldiers without a home. Broken buildings. And as if in a dream, I approached the heart of the city, now still, where 2 years earlier I was surrounded by so many vibrant children.
I saw an inch order. Inch line. Մենք ո՞ր քաղաքում ենք հիմա։
Leaving Stepanakert, the pain deepened. I knew that within a few breathless days, Azerbaijan would reign over much of this soil, the result of a peace accord that devastated Armenians, leaving thousands of years of creation in Azerbaijan's choking grip. The first century BC Dikranagerd, land of Dikran the Great, its fortress and recently discovered ancient city, churches and cross stones, no longer ours and the world's to explore and preserve, and overlooking, perched atop the mountain, We're at Van Kasat. At the top of the mountain where Dikranagerd stood 2,000 plus years ago. And nearby, a hidden gem. There is a church and a cave here. We're in Askeran. Don't step on the wire. You have to watch where you're walking here. Climbing up the mountain. Okay. Here's the cave. This is the cave church. An Armenian church. Hos Khachka, Nair. Hos. Nair, 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 Hos, Hos.
Ah, Aisa.
A pilgrimage worth the risky climb. We had to say goodbye, at least for now, to Artsakh's beloved Dadivank, its last candle sending prayers into the heavens, its brave priest and parishioners. And then down the road, along the river, to the 12th century Surp Ast Bazadin Monastery, sitting quietly, without ado. A few of so many Armenian monuments, homes, ways of life to be left to aggressors who have made clear their mission to destroy. Winding through the majestic cliffs of Armenian Karvachar, ruin of village after village, absolute desolation. Tiprot. They burnt their homes and left. So the Azeris get none of it. They said goodbye to the mountain and to Artsakh, reaching Armenia, with Mount Ararat watching, grieving over her heroes. A generation of youth lost defending their families and homeland. For those whose sons are still missing, death may be more tolerable. And for those still living, tens of thousands displaced, one door closed, another is open by virtue of their resilience and the goodwill of others. I'm in a building in Mezamor, outside of Yerevan, where many dislocated, uprooted people from Artsakh are living in conditions we don't imagine. And Oran is helping with essentials. Cesar's here, passing out necessities of life. Leaving Yerevan and its surroundings, a friend took me to the city of Goriz. It's in the border region of Syunik, itself in a vulnerable position, with growing concern that it may be next. Here, the largest concentration of displaced Artsakh citizens is struggling to survive in hotels. Kindergartens.
Քանի դուք ստեղ եք եւ բոլորով քեզ տեղ գալիս են, մեր միակ նպատակը հոգ տանել ձեր մասին, ձեր պայմանները քիչ ավելի լավացնել եւ հույս ունենալով, որ վաղ ավելի լավոր կլինի, սա է մեր խնդիրը։
And homes.
Բաց քանի հոգի դապտի։
Այս փոքրիկ երկու փոքրիկ սենյակներ է, 7 մեծեր եւ 12 փոքրիկ երեխաներ են ապրում։
These children and thousands like them have lost their homes, their schools, friends, a whole way of life, some even their fathers. But they haven't lost their hopes and dreams. People and organizations are doing what they can to help, but there is so much yet to be done. Without hesitation, let's help make their dreams reality.
So they matter. They belong to us. We all belong to each other. We belong. And I believe, I have faith that truth and right and good will prevail, and that we all have a place, a role, a purpose for that. So Shrana Galtyun. Yev Kisher Padi, thank you to all of you. And I'll turn it over to the wonderful organizers. And thank you again for doing it.
Ani, I just want to thank you so much for bringing your gifts to bear on this community tonight. You have an absolute gift. And we are so thankful just for enlightening us to everything that's gone on in Armenia and everything that is going on continuing to this day, that this isn't just something that is in the history books that we most definitely need to remember, but it is also something that is continuing today. And if you're like me, this is so much to take in, and there's no way that we could possibly cover everything that we need to cover in an hour and a half. And so it really, it begs the question, what do we do with this? How do we show up in this conversation? How do we continue to show up for our brothers and sisters in the Armenian community? And we just want to do two things to end the night. The first thing that we're going to do is we're going to drop in the chat just some continuing resources. If this is a new conversation to you, or if this is a new reality that you are starting to wrap your mind around, we want to implore you to continue in your learning, continue in your understanding, continue in your relationships with our Armenian brothers and sisters. And so we will drop that in the chat so that you can see the continued resources. And please continue on in your, not only education, but in your relationships and in your understanding, so that we can show up as brothers and sisters. And if you're a Christian in this space tonight, that we can show up as brothers and sisters in Christ and bring about justice and reconciliation for Armenian brothers and sisters. And the other thing that I want to encourage us to do in scripture, we really, man, there's this biblical principle of lament. And this biblical principle of lament calls us to acknowledge loss, to acknowledge devastation, to mourn over what has happened. And this is all an act of worship to a God who sees us and who is with us in our pain and in our sorrow. So we're going to take a minute here, and I believe we have some prompts that we are going to put on the screen. And as we put these prompts on the screen, I just want you to take a moment and write out a short lament. And this is two ways that we can do this. You have the lament prompts that you can see on the screen, and there's just this biblical communal value of worshiping God through lament, knowing that he sees us, knowing that he is with us. And I'm going to ask us to write your short lament, and please put it in the chat. Put it in the chat here. And then the other thing that we would ask you to do is to, if this is just too short of a time and space to do that, please write your lament out and send it to us. Hannah will put an email in the chat that you can send your lament to. And what we're going to do is have you send your lament to us, and we will post it on the Center for Racial Reconciliation Facebook pages, just so that we can have a time that we can point back to this time that we've had together and have laments coming out of this time together, and that this isn't something that just gets contained to this time in this space. So you can see that you can send your laments to reconciliation@madeforfellowship.com. And I see some of these laments starting to come into the chat. So please take a moment. I'm just going to give us a minute and a half here. Please just take a moment. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our laments. Oh God, we know that you are with us. God, we know that you are with the Armenian community, our Armenian brothers and sisters. And God, we stand with them. We lament with them, not only over the past, and not only over the atrocities of the past, but of the atrocities of the present day and the injustices that have happened in this present day. We lament and we stand with. So I'm going to give you a minute just to write those laments. I see them coming in the chats. Please keep writing them and putting them in the chat. If you don't have the time or the margin or the space in your mind right now or in your heart to write a lament, again, you can scroll up a little bit further in the chat before the lament started to come in, and you can see where you can write us your laments. reconciliation@madeforfellowship.com. We will post these on our Facebook page in remembrance of our time and our night together. Again, we just want to say we are so deeply grateful that you have joined us. I want to invite Doris back to join us. And she's going to close our time in prayer together. And Doris and Arda, the content that you brought was so powerful. And we would just want to thank you so much for bringing your gifts to bear tonight for all of us. And we do just want to apologize so deeply that technology got in the way. And I know that's so disappointing. But we just want to say that we see you and we're so, so grateful for the work that you're doing and for bringing your work to bear in this space tonight. So if you would close us in prayer, we would be so thankful.
Sure. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. You are an awesome God, and we praise you, Lord. We thank you for this Armenian nation that has chosen to worship you, to love you, regardless of all the persecution that they have endured. We thank you for their faithfulness, and we thank you for watching over our precious nation. Lord, there are times when we don't understand what is happening. We don't understand your ways. We don't understand why we must suffer. But Lord, may we always be reminded that you have promised to be with us, to guide us, to watch over us, and to be there in our pain. Lord, we thank you that you have allowed us to cry out to you in our pain, to come to you with our questions of why and how long, Lord. And Lord, as we struggle, when we see injustice, when we're hurting or suffering, Lord, may we cling to your promises that you will never forsake us, that you are always with us, that you love us. You sent your Son to die for us so that we could have eternal life with you. And Lord, may the experiences of suffering and pain make us more compassionate towards others who are hurting in this world. Lord, may we reach them with your love, with be your hands and your feet. May we see those who are hurting and share your love with them. Lord, I ask that you bless this wonderful community, a fellowship, and I pray for everyone who has attended tonight. And I pray that you will strengthen us so that we can reach out to this hurting world. Bless us, Lord, in your precious name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Doris and Arda, just for, again, joining us tonight and for your leadership in this space. We just want to thank you. I wish we could see every face that's joining us tonight, because we know there's a lot of you, and we know that you're joining from literally all over the world. We had somebody from Argentina in here tonight. So we just want to thank you. And we just want to invite you to continue on in the conversation, to continue on with the resources that we shared with you, and really to continue on with the Center for Racial Reconciliation and all the work that we're doing. We are continuing on in this work because this is gospel work, and especially if you're a Christian in the space, continuing in the conversation with us. We love you so much. Have a great night.